V2PTE Academic. We are providing online PTE coaching and monthly practice test. You can also stay connected with us. Facebook, Instagram and Telegram. For more information visit our WhatsApp on given number. Subscribe our YouTube channel and press the bell icon for more updates.
tests should be administered by a medical expert. Collecting the raw materials proved a long and laborious task. The company will arrange a taxi to meet you at the airport. Organizational failure is considered from various perspectives in academic literature. This Thursday is the last day for students to withdraw subjects without any penalty. students are encouraged to think carefully about their accommodation needs.
V2PT. V2PT. V2PT.
We make our countertops with quartz, our clothes with cotton, our windows with glass, and our streets with asphalt because water can't dissolve these materials. They're made mostly of molecules with no charged parts. It would be silly to build, say, windows out of something that can dissolve in water, like sugar, unless you're going to eat them. And lots of the substances that water does dissolve, like washable markers, are things we've engineered so that they can be washed away. We've also engineered versions that aren't dissolvable in water for when we don't want them to be washed away. By making sure water dissolves what we want it to, and only what we want it to, we've been able to adapt our lives to a world in which water dissolves so much stuff. We humans also literally adapted to a world in which water dissolves so much stuff. The outer layer of our skin is built in a way that makes it uncharged, and therefore undissolvable. And the membrane surrounding each of the cells inside us has a similar undissolvable layer. The only reason we humans exist at all on this watery planet were that trees, fish, bacteria, or anything else exists is that we evolved barriers that could keep water from dissolving us into goo. Any life forms that didn't were simply dead in the water.
In 2012, after reviewing the evidence, the American Medical Association released a major statement. Nightlight can disrupt your sleep cycle. However, for whatever reason, not many people have since been informed about it. So, here's the basics of what you need to know. When you're exposed to a significant amount of light, specifically of the blue wavelength, your body suppresses melatonin production to make you feel more awake. Normally, this evolutionary design works pretty well. With the coming of night and day, our melatonin levels waxes and wanes, giving us our circadian rhythm. However, since the invention of artificial lights, we're being exposed to more and more light at nighttime, and these effects can be pretty big. Here's what happens when you place participants in a room with similar brightness to your average household. This is where their melatonin levels would normally be if they were sleeping in a dark room, and here's their melatonin levels in that lit room. You can see the huge suppression of melatonin. And it doesn't take too much to see these effects either.
What is the word for somebody who works but doesn't get paid?
Volunteer.
Which word refers to a period of 10 years?
Decade.
What is the word for a person who is required to contribute a portion of their income to the government?
Taxpayer.
What do you call something that is a much smaller version of an actual building?
Model.
What term is used for a very popular book that millions of people have bought?
Bestseller. Blockbuster.
What do you call the space at the back of a car used for carrying and storing things?
Boot, trunk, luggage compartment.
What white substance do people usually write with on a traditional classroom blackboard?
Chalk.
What do you call the leather seat on a horse for a rider to sit on?
Saddle.
What do you call a large image of a sports or music star that teenagers often have on their bedroom walls?
Poster.
What is the term for a small part of something, such as a quarter or a fifth?
Fraction.
What type of evidence is based on scientific experimentation or actual experience rather than theory?
Empirical.
What do we call the problem of pupils intentionally missing school without permission?
Truancy.
What is the name for a person who regularly travels to work?
Commuter.
V2PT.
Thank you, PT.
V2PT. 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 V2PT.
Research has shown that in certain situations, silent meetings actually work better. Specifically, if the goal of a meeting is to brainstorm or solve a problem, silent meetings have been shown to generate better ideas. But why? Solutions to a problem will often be a novel idea, and novel ideas challenge convention. They can rock the boat and make people feel uncomfortable. But when participants gather around a table and generate written solutions in silence, a safe space is created. Novel ideas can emerge, and people are less afraid of feeling embarrassed. Silent meetings also circumvent negative effects of something called production blocking. In a conventional meeting, only one person at a time can speak. As you wait your turn, the conversation may shift and you may lose your opportunity to raise an idea. Silent meetings allow for everyone to express ideas simultaneously. So how do you create a silent brainstorming meeting? Have people write down their ideas independently, then sort them into clusters, discuss, and vote on the ideas that people like. The key is to let the initial ideation phase happen independently and in silence, so we can separate egos from ideas. Silence is just one alternative. Since meetings have different goals, there's no reason they all have to look or sound the same.
For many, these have been vital considerations for the future of artificial intelligence. But British computer scientist Alan Turing decided to disregard all these questions in favor of a much simpler one. Can a computer talk like a human? This question led to an idea for measuring artificial intelligence that would famously come to be known as the Turing test. In the 1950 paper, Computing Machinery and Intelligence, Turing proposed the following game. A human judge has a text conversation with unseen players and evaluates their responses. To pass the test, a computer must be able to replace one of the players without substantially changing the results. In other words, a computer would be considered intelligent if its conversation couldn't be easily distinguished from a human's. Turing predicted that by the year 2000, machines with 100 megabytes of memory would be able to easily pass his test. But he may have jumped the gun.
Okay, class. Today we will talk about Roman doctors at the beginning of the first century. As we noted in our previous class, there was a 15-year-long war after Julius Caesar was assassinated. The war was severe. The number of injured was so many. There were so many that it became one of the top priorities of the new emperor to give medical care to those in need. It was around this time that the new emperor, Augustus, started thinking about upgrading the status of doctors. He realized that medical care was key to the empire and especially an army. In order to improve the medical system, he needed better doctors. So he started making the profession look more enticing. All army doctors were entitled to attend the new army medical school and were given dignified titles, land grants, and special retirement benefits. Before this, doctors had a fairly low status.
If you are unsure of drawing directly in pen and ink, start off with a light pencil sketch. This will allow you to make sure that your proportions are correct and that you are happy with the composition. Take a few minutes to study your subject, this chair and violin. Notice how the straight lines of the chair differ from the curves of the violin. Once you are ready to begin drawing, define the shape of the chair with clean straight lines. Then add contrast by drawing the outline of the violin with gently curved lines. You may have to apply more pressure to the nib when drawing curved lines to allow the ink to flow easily. When you have drawn the outlines of both objects,
the complex process inside a leaf takes energy from the sun and uses it to convert water and carbon dioxide into sugars. During this process, photosynthesis, plants convert light energy into chemical energy. All leaves carry out photosynthesis in basically the same way. First, the pores on the leaf's outer skin open up and take in molecules of carbon dioxide. Water absorbed by the roots is transported upward through the plant, and it enters the leaf through its stem. Carbon dioxide and water, these are the raw materials for photosynthesis. Once carbon dioxide and water are present, photosynthesis can begin. The chemical reactions of photosynthesis take place in two stages, the light-dependent reactions and the light-independent reactions. When sunlight shines on a leaf during the light-dependent stage, its energy is absorbed by molecules of chlorophyll, which you all know is the pigment giving a leaf its green color. The light energy absorbed by the chlorophyll is used to split the hydrogen and oxygen in the water. Then, during the light-independent reactions, hydrogen from the water combines with carbon dioxide and forms carbohydrates, including the sugar glucose, but also other molecules that are rich in food energy for the plant. In the process, excess oxygen is released to the outside air through the leaf's pores. Finally, the plant transports the products of photosynthesis. Microscopic veins in the leaf carry the food out through the stem and into the cells of the plant. This process continues all throughout the growing season, that is, as long as the leaves remain green.
Avalanches are a constant threat on mountain highways. The Rogers Pass stretch of the Trans-Canada is at risk of being buried in snow from November to April every year. This is why the highway now has a sophisticated defense system. The best way, it's important to control an avalanche when it's small, so a slide is set off while it's still small before it builds up into a serious danger. A team of snow technicians monitors the snowpack. They sort of read the snow and try to predict when it's likely to slide. They study data from the weather stations in the mountains. As the danger increases, they drop explosives onto test slopes to see if the snow can be made to slide. It's kind of tricky trying to decide just when the snow will slide. The weight of the snow, together with the force of gravity, is what starts an avalanche. The technicians don't want to wait till it's too late, but if they're too early, before conditions are just right, the snow won't release. When the time is right, they close the road and remove all traffic from the pass. Most closures last 2 to 4 hours. Then the Army comes in. A 10-man artillery crew operates a mobile 105-millimeter howitzer, firing shells into the slopes. This sends out shock waves that trigger the avalanches. Slides are set off one by one. The technicians direct the action, telling the troops where to aim the gun. Visibility can be awful. Then they have to check and see if the avalanche has released well enough. Sometimes they drive their trucks below the slide path, kind of dangerous work, and they listen to the snow come down. Sometimes, if the slide is bigger than they expected, they might have to make a speedy getaway.
In animals, a movement is coordinated by a cluster of neurons in the spinal cord called the Central Contract Pattern Generator, CPG. This produces signals that drive muscles to contract rhythmically in a way that produces running or walking, depending on the pattern of pulse. A simple signal from the brain instructs the CPG to switch between modes, such as going from a standstill to walking.
V2PT.
Lawrence Stephen Lowry RBS Raw was an English artist. Many of his drawings and paintings depict Pendlebury, Lancashire, where he lived and worked for more than 40 years, and also Salford and its surrounding areas. Lowry is famous for painting scenes of life in the industrial districts of northwest England in the mid-20th century. He developed a distinctive style of painting and is best known for his city landscapes peopled with human figures often referred to as Matchstick Man. He painted mysterious unpopulated landscapes, brooding portraits, and the unpublished marionette works, which were only found after his death.
V2PT.
Now that story has been scotched as a part of a contingency plan, but it was a symptom of the dramatic turn of events in South Australia, and it flushed out other remarks from water academics and people like Tim Flannery, indicating that things were really much worse than had been foreshadowed even earlier this year. So is Adelaide, let alone some whole regions of South Australia, in serious bother? Considering that the vast amount of its drinking water comes from the beleaguered Miri, something many of us outside the state may not have quite realized. Is there a predicament, something we have to face up to as a nation?
V2PT.
Those of you who've never heard of the term Neo-Latin may be forgiven for thinking it's a new South American dance craze. If you're puzzled when I tell you it has something to do with the language of Romans, take heart. Over the years, many classes who have confessed they are not really sure what it is either. Some have assumed that they are so-called Late Latin, written at the end of the Roman Empire. Others have supposed it must have been something to do with the Middle Ages. Or perhaps it's that Pseudo-Latin, which my 5 and 7-year-old boys seem to have gleaned from the Harry Potter books, useful for spells and curses that they zip one another with makeshift paper ash wands. No, in fact, Neo-Latin is more or less the same as the Latin that was written in the ancient world, classic Latin. So what's so new about it?
V2PT.
Are you going to be more effective and happy as a specialist or as a generalist? Do you find real satisfaction in the precision, order, and system of a clearly laid out job? Or are you one of those people who tend to grow impatient with anything that looks like a routine job? There are a great many careers in which the emphasis is on specialization. You find these careers in engineering and in accounting, in production, in statistical work, and in teaching. But there is an increasing demand for people who are able to take in a great area at a glance. There is, in other words, a demand for people who are capable of seeing the forest rather than the trees, of making overall.
The theory of personality types suggests there are pairs of what are known as type preferences. Type preferences are not the same as character traits that can be worked on and changed. Rather, they're preferred ways of being in the world, different ways of experiencing daily life. One well-known pair of type preferences is extroversion-introversion. Some people are extroverts and some are introverts. Extroverted people are by nature continuously aware of events outside of themselves. Extroverts turn outward to the world around them to pick up ideas, values, and interests. Extroverts, therefore, usually have a variety of interests and sort of take an active approach to life. Introversion is just the opposite. Introverts look inward for resources. Introverts pursue fewer interests, but on a much deeper level. They sort of take a reflective approach to life. What I mean is they involve themselves in inner events, ideas, and impressions. Introverted people usually prefer to learn in private.
For some people, this proposition may seem far-fetched, but ending poverty is both morally necessary and actually feasible. All of us must play a role in making it happen. All human beings want and have a right to live in dignity, to determine our own destinies, and to be respected by other people. Despite the universality of these rights, our capacities to fulfill them vary enormously. And no dividing line is more profound in influencing the quality of our lives than the gulf between poverty and prosperity.
Well, there's a positive obligation on the bank to ensure that the people who are signing a loan guarantee know what they're doing. Loan guarantees are kind of unique in that someone is giving security or a guarantee and placing themselves at risk for someone else, and they receive nothing material in return. So you've got to ask yourself, why is this person doing this? Do they know what they're doing? They're risking a lot and not really getting anything back for it. So the imperative is that the bank must ensure that these people know what they're doing and that they fully understand the implications of what they're doing, and they know that their properties may be sold if another person doesn't meet their obligations. No, that was, and that's an important aspect. As you alluded to earlier, we've previously done work which has proven that in some situations, even people whose blood pressure is not high can benefit from blood pressure lowering therapy. So in this study, the main reason that we included patients was because of diabetes. We didn't care what their blood pressure was, whether it was high or low. And our objective was to see whether or not lowering average or below average blood pressure in diabetics was beneficial, and the results suggested that irrespective of whether your blood pressure was high or low, if you had diabetes, you benefited.
Different factors affect the freezing time of water. The subject is complex and difficult to explain. Most of penguins live in southern Atlantic Sea.